Last week, lab-grown meat hit the headlines as it was approved for sale for the first time ever anywhere in the world. Chicken nuggets with real chicken meat made without killing a single chicken. It sounds too good to be true. So what is lab-grown meat? Why is lab-grown meat? And in a world full of new plant-based meat alternatives, is it even worth it anymore? We all know what traditional, normal, standard meat is. It's the flesh that's come from a once living animal. And we normally just eat the muscle and the fat tissue and leave behind the bits like, you know, bone or feathers or fur or scales. And it's important to state now that normal meat, traditional meat, is made of animal cells. So when you're eating chicken, you're eating chicken cells. When you're eating beef, you're eating cow cells. All your everyday standard meat, you're eating cells. Lab-grown meat, also known as cultured meat, is also meat that's just made of animal cells. But the big difference is that those animal cells were grown in a lab rather than being grown in an animal. So in a normal adult animal, you've got cells that are specialized for different tasks. So you've got muscle cells in your muscle, you've got fat cells in your fat, and then you've also got a few special cells called stem cells. Unless you're a plant, they don't go on to make stems. They can in fact make any of the other types of cells. That's what's so special about them. So if you take some of those stem cells and put them in a lab, and give them the right nutrients, the right temperature, the right environment to grow, they can divide and divide, sometimes indefinitely. And then you can tell them, I want you to become a muscle cell. I want you to become fat cell. And this gives you a potentially limitless source of animal cells.
So my name is Vitor Santo. I am the director of cellular agriculture at EatJust. We got the first worldwide regulatory approval for commercialization of cultured meat and used cultured chicken to be sold in Singapore.
Let's talk about this vat of chicken cells, because in my head, you've got a massive tank full of like this nutrient broth with just chicken cells floating in it. First of all, do you see like clumps of chicken cells, or are they just individual and you sieve them out at the end?
Yeah, that's exactly how it looks like, actually. When you look at the bioreactor, the vat, it's you know, it starts with a more diluted culture broth, and at the end of the reaction, if you look at it, it's really like dense and opaque, because you really and then as you get closer, you actually can see some of those aggregates. Yes.
And what is that nutrient broth that they're suspended in? What are you feeding these chicken cells?
It comprises a mixture of amino acids, vitamins, sugars, salts, and lipids. That's essentially, you know, it.
To understand why researchers have been studying lab-grown meat for decades, and why companies are still investing millions into it, you've first got to understand some of the problems with growing meat the traditional way, that is, farming livestock. Let's start off with the big one, greenhouse gas emissions. So the UN estimates that 14.5% of all of the world's greenhouse gas emissions comes from rearing livestock. To put that in some context, all of the transport in the world is responsible for just 14% of greenhouse gas emissions. All of aviation is just 2.5%. Now, a big part of the emissions from rearing livestock comes from the inevitable consequence of having a large number of animals with ruminant stomachs, specialized digestive systems. That is, they burp. 40% of all of the emissions from rearing livestock comes from burps. It's crazy. Scientists are actually looking into feeding cows seaweed to make them burp less, the poor things. But either way, there's always going to be methane and CO2 emissions, just as a consequence of having a lot of animals that are just staying alive. The other more hidden greenhouse gas emissions from growing livestock comes from feed production and deforestation. it takes a lot of land to grow animals. You've got to have space for all of your millions of cows, your chickens, your pigs. But it also takes a lot of land to grow the feed to feed to those cows, chickens, or pigs. It takes 3 kilos of feed to make just 1 kilo of chicken meat. Whereas to produce 1 kilo of beef, it takes 25 kilos of animal feed. And it's mostly soy that we're feeding to these animals. Soy, as a plant species, isn't inherently bad for the environment, but increasingly farmers are chopping down rainforest to provide space to grow all this soy. Obviously, chopping down rainforest has some pretty serious global warming implications. And then they will ship it all over the world just to produce cheap animal feed. It's estimated that a third of all of the habitable land on Earth either has livestock on it or has crops growing on it to feed the livestock. And all of this land that's used for livestock is land that we could be using to restore habitats for wildlife and to create new carbon sinks, like planting forests that will slow down global warming. With a lot of animals, you also end up with a lot of something else. Poo. And boy, do we have a lot of poo. We are currently in the midst of a poo crisis on planet Earth, but nobody is talking about all the poo. So poo is naturally very high in nitrogen and phosphorus, which is why in small amounts, we add it to fields as a fertilizer. But we do not have small amounts of poo. Oh no, we have inordinate amounts of poo. We have mountains of poo. We have literal lakes of poo. And all of this poo can wash away into our water systems and literally kill our wildlife with all of the natural chemicals. And it's not just the wildlife who suffers, it also hurts humans. Obviously, there's bacteria in poo, and if that gets into our drinking water, it can cause diseases. But just the sheer quantity of poo that we have releases so many chemicals that it gets into our lungs and irritates them, and all that air pollution causes respiratory diseases. We are literally being poisoned by poo. Last week, Singapore gave approval for lab-grown chicken nuggets to go on sale to the general public. This is a big deal because this is the first time that there's been approval for any lab-grown meat product anywhere in the world. But each of those chicken nuggets, each costs 40 quid. No company is currently making lab-grown meat at a commercially viable scale. And yet still, companies are investing a huge amount of R&D and money into it. So why are they betting on lab-grown meat being the future of food? The big idea behind lab-grown meat is that we only grow the parts of the animal that we're actually going to eat. So we don't eat feathers or fur or hooves. So why waste all of that animal feed on bits of the animal that we're not going to eat? And also, it takes a lot of feed just to keep an animal alive before it even starts growing more flesh. As a human animal, it takes about 1500 calories worth of feed for me to stay alive, for me to stay warm, for my heart to pump, my brain to keep running, to digest my food. That is a lot of energy just to keep me alive. And it's the same with farm animals. It takes a lot of feed just to keep the animal upright before it even starts growing meat for us. A lot of the carbon emissions in traditional farming are quite difficult to avoid. It's quite hard to stop cows from burping and to stop manure from releasing methane. Whereas with lab-grown meat, a lot of the carbon emissions come from using energy in the form of electricity. Now, if you're going to use electricity from coal-powered plants and dirty energy, it's obviously going to release an awful lot of carbon dioxide and worse into the environment. And you do wonder what's the point. But the good thing about electricity is it's very easy to swap out dirty energy for clean energy like solar power and wind power. And in that case, that is just going to slash the carbon emissions of lab-grown meat even further. Because of all this, lab-grown meat could be hugely more efficient than traditional meat. It can use less land, less energy, and produce less greenhouse gas emissions. Right now, we don't really have any hard evidence. We don't know how much CO2 lab-grown meat will produce because it's only being produced at small scales, which are inherently inefficient. But one estimate suggests that lab-grown meat could use 98% less land and produce up to 95% less greenhouse gas emissions than traditional meat. And if that happens, that is going to be big news, because our demand for meat is only increasing. In 2050, it's set to be double what it was in 2000, as countries like China become richer, and not only can people afford to eat more meat, but meat, and particularly beef, is a strong aspirational status symbol, so people want to buy more meat. Making meat with only 5% of the greenhouse gas emissions and 2% of the land use of traditional meat sounds like it's going to save the world. But as always on this channel, the truth is a little bit more complicated than that. For a start, the amount of greenhouse gases emitted from producing 1 kilo of meat can vary drastically depending on what meat it is, what country you're in, and the farming practices you use. This is a fantastic graphic from Our World in Data that shows the greenhouse gas emissions for different types of protein. And you can see that depending on the animal, it changes the greenhouse gas emissions hugely. But you can also see within an animal how much variation there is. So look how variable the greenhouse gas emissions for beef production are. The UK is incredibly efficient when it comes to producing meat, especially beef and dairy. Globally, producing a kilo of beef emits 99 kilos of CO2, whereas in the UK, the average is only 24 kilos of CO2, and it can be as low as 17. A big part of that is just we have the climate for growing grass, and so the vast majority of our cows are fed on grass, and so we don't have to chop down rainforests to produce soy cattle feed. And also, we tend to get our beef from dairy herds rather than from dedicated beef herds, which is just a more efficient process. And as I've mentioned before, in the EU, we do not pump our animals full of antibiotics. So all of this just goes to show it is possible to produce climate-friendly, antibiotic-free meat without a lab. Unfortunately, if everyone wanted to eat this happy grass-fed meat, there wouldn't be enough to match current meat consumption. But that just means we need to reduce our meat consumption. Livestock also play a hugely important role in carbon capture and in conservation. All of these fields of grass are actively sequestering carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and into the soil. And in fact, a well-managed pasture field can trap pretty much the same amount of carbon as planting new trees. Nature reserves in the UK are now adding livestock, because adding livestock just creates a more stable ecosystem. And in the absence of top predators like wolves and bears, the only way to manage livestock numbers is to cull them, and you produce meat in the process. Now, lab-grown meat does use far less land than traditional meat. So as long as we're wise and we use the extra land that frees up for conservation and for carbon capture, this shouldn't be a problem. But since when have governments ever been wise when it comes to climate change? But perhaps the most shocking side of lab-grown meat, given that it is often marketed as a potential protein source for vegans, given that it doesn't require the death of an animal, is that the cells are grown in bovine fetal serum. Now, BFS is an amazing liquid. It is packed full of nutrients and all natural hormones that you need to grow cells in a lab. But the way you get it is to drain the blood of an unborn calf. And to get one of those, you have to kill a pregnant cow, which is hardly vegan. Not to mention, it is so expensive to make and it requires a huge long line of pregnant cows that you're willing to slaughter. And yes, this is more of an ethical issue than an environmental one, but marketing your product by saying it does not require the death of a single animal is frankly a lie.
So your chief executive, Josh Tetrick, was quoted in the Financial Times as saying, "For the first time, meat from real animals that hasn't required a single animal to be killed or a single tree to be cut down can be sold." Given that the current chicken nuggets require fetal bovine serum, do you think that is a fair, accurate thing to say?
Yeah, I think that it was definitely focusing more on the chicken component, right? And due to the fact that nowadays we are actually already just producing in serum free. However, when we initiated the discussions with the regulatory bodies in Singapore, at the time, we're still using a very low percentage of serum. So the first commercial product is still cultured that way.
So why did you not wait until you'd found an alternative to fetal bovine serum before starting the regulatory steps?
I understand why some people might feel that this is not the right approach. And I think that at the end of the day, the main message here is that we have generated a process internally where we don't need to kill any more chicken or any other animal in the future. Especially now being serum free.
Just because traditional meat can be bad for the environment doesn't mean that lab-grown meat is the solution. The number of people who are reducing the amount of meat they eat day to day, whether they're becoming full-on vegan or vegetarian, or just meat reducers, is rapidly increasing. We currently eat far more meat than we need as a protein source, or than is healthy for our bowels. Short of having fewer children, eating less meat is the single best thing that we can do for the environment. And plenty of people, including farmers and butchers, are saying that we should eat less meat, but focus on eating higher quality, more humanely produced meat, and seeing meat as the occasional treat rather than a requirement for every meal. Plus, we now have plant-based meat alternatives, and I swear there is a new meat alternative popping up left, right, and center these days. It's so hard to keep track of them all. So I decided to do a blind taste test comparing 3 vegetarian chicken nuggets to 2 meat chicken nuggets.
So this is soy. This is soy and wheat. This is mycoprotein, so fungus. This is chicken and potato. And this is chicken. It tastes like chicken, doesn't taste like chicken. It has a surprisingly good texture. Okay, tastes like chicken. That tastes like bread if someone had soaked it in chicken stock. It's not chicken, but it's also not anything else either.
Frankly, it was very difficult to tell the difference between the vegetarian butcher brand and, you know, actual chicken.
Also indistinguishable from a chicken nugget. It was a lot tougher. Boy, does that taste like chicken. That is indistinguishable. To be fair, this is the only one that I fried of the 5. It's not giving me a flavour of fake chicken. This one just doesn't taste of anything except the coating. Which arguably is better. Because the best bit of a chicken nugget is the coating anyway. I'm very surprised that that is so good.
And if it is that difficult to tell the difference between plant-based meat and, you know, meat, then why not just eat the plants? We need to stop thinking of meat alternatives as the vegetarian option, something only for vegetarians and vegans. But we need to get more meat eaters eating them. Ultimately, a lot of the problems with traditional meat can already be solved by eating less meat and by choosing meat that has been raised in a more environmentally friendly way and by increasing the amount of meat alternatives that we eat. Certainly that's what I try to do to have less of an impact on the planet. But I don't think that lab-grown meat is made for people like me. I think it has been designed for people who are adamant about eating meat with every meal and who are happy to buy cheap, intensively farmed meat regardless of the environmental consequences. Lab-grown meat has huge potential as well in countries where traditional meat farming has a big environmental impact, unlike in the UK. So whether that is because farming requires deforestation or climate change has made the weather so unpredictable that it's just not easy to have traditional farming, or like in Singapore, there isn't the space for traditional farming. For those people, having lab-grown meat instead of traditional meat could have a huge impact on their carbon footprint, and that has got to be a good thing. Now the big issue is going to be public opinion. Will regulatory bodies like the EU and the FSA even allow lab-grown meat if it requires artificial growth hormones and nutrient additives? And given how the public overreacted to genetically modified foods, are people even willing to eat cells that have been grown in a lab in such artificial conditions? Only time will tell. A big thank you to Merck for paying for this video as part of their Curiosity initiative. They've got a load more information about lab-grown meat, and in particular lab-grown burgers, on their website, and there's a link in the description below. By using that link, you're also saying thank you to them for funding this channel, which is a nice thing to do. And a better thing to do than staring at my kitchen in the background, which I know you've been doing for the whole of this video.